truck?
Hello, hello?
Hey.
Yeah, it's a quite strange instrument. However, we will try to use it.
Yeah, so you can make sure that you can see it. Essa ali na aspira dos pés, sim, preto.
You okay? No?
No, why is that boat okay?
We always.
Yeah.
It's very good, very good. Right.
Sveiki visiem! Es esmu Ieva Puzo, Latvijas antropologa biedrības valdes priekšsēdētāja, un kopā ar savu kolēģiem Elīnu Ozoliņu un Annu Žabicku, kur diemžēl šoreiz šeit nav. Mēs esam ļoti priecīgi jūs redzēt šajā pasākumā. Mums prieks, ka mūsu pasākuma, reklamēšanas pasākumi ir diezgan izdevušies, un jūs šeit tādā kuplā skaitā. Un šovakar mēs dzirdēsim lekciju par daudzsugu Amazonu, par cilvēciskā un ārpus cilvēciskā satikšanos šajā kontekstā. Un šī vakara lektors ir Parīdz Boletins, kurš 2011. Gadā ir beidzis Sienas universitāti. Un jau vairāk kā 10 gadus strādā ar Mebengokre cilti Brazīlijā. Un viņa intereses ir šie ārcilvēciskā un ārpus cilvēciskā satikšanās jautājumi šajā Amazonas kontekstā. So, I'll switch to English, and without much further ado, join me in welcoming Parīdz Boletins.
Thank you, Ieva. Thank you to the Latvian Association of Anthropologists, and thank you to all of you. I was not expecting so much people, but I'm very happy for this, and I hope later on we can discuss in a productive way. However, we are going to talk about multispecies Amazon and encounters between animism and anthropomorphism. So we are going to talk about a world that will be full of people like this room now. So it will be something that we can be quite familiar in this moment. So we are going to observe different kind of actors that will be present in our discussion now. Are you listening there? Yeah, closer? Yeah, okay. I'm not used to this, so it's quite a strange situation. And so we are going to talk about Mebengokre. We are going to talk about ethologists. We are going to talk about turtles, monkeys, and so many others. We will discuss just a few. Well, I would like to ask you something before. How many anthropologists there are here? Yeah, good. No, well, it is more a good percentage, more than the normal in the society. So it's a good situation to talk. Yeah, so perfect. So all of you knows, I think, all of you have some familiarities with animals, I think. Who of you? Wow, just a few people. Someone of you have a dog? Has a dog? Wow, someone else? A cat? Wow, a lot of cats. Wow. Riga is the city of cats.
Of course.
Yeah, it's for this reason there are more cats than dogs. However, we will not talk about dogs and cats, but I think that is interesting to think about the way we are relating with animals. Animals as a part of a wider panorama inhabited of so many different subjectivities. Is okay there? So far? Yeah, okay. So, along the history of anthropology, animals have been analyzed in different ways. One of them is that animals are good to eat. So animals are the humans produce a relation with animals because animals are a productive tool they have. For example, we can eat a pig, we can eat a cow, we can eat somewhere also dogs and cats. However, this is not the case. But it is interesting because in this point of view, we have animals in a quite materialistic approach, observed from a materialistic point of view. They are something that are useful, but useful just to eat, in the sense that they are it is a pragmatic use. Well, I will not enter in so many quotation of authors, because maybe it cannot be interesting for the most part of you. However, if you want, we can discuss all of this later on. But the animals can be observed also as good to think with. What does it mean? It means that animals are a conceptual tool. They are symbols, they are signs. They can be something that let us organize the world. They produce the first difference that human uses in their experience of the world. And so they are something that let the people to produce an organization in their experiences. Is clear? Someone has some question already? No? Some critic too? No? Okay. Wow. It's good, the first 2 minutes without critics. Yeah. But animals can be also good to live with. So they can be beings that share their our lives with us. Let me open a small parenthesis, and here I think that somebody can make a critic to me. If Riga is the city of cats, you are living with cats, and you are sharing the space, and in some way, cats are producing the space in which you are living on, isn't it? Do you agree with me? Yeah? So what does it mean that we live together with other beings, in this case, animals? That when we observe the reality, when we are trying to produce an interpretation, we are trying to produce a description of the reality, of some cultural reality that we are observing as anthropologists, but as people in everywhere, we have to think about a kind of multi-species ethnography. What does it mean? Multi-species ethnography is a way to observing in which all the beings, not only humans, are the focus of our observation. They are proper subjects, and as subjects, we have to observe them as part of the plethora of actors which are producing the experience we are observing. Is clear? Yeah? Okay, so let's start with the first one. What do you think that this is?
A tortoise
shell. Yeah, fantastic. Is the body painting representing turtle. It's nice, and we are going to see what does it mean later on. Caprin is the term my Bengal Cree people use to call the turtle. And we will see later on how it is called in science. I don't like this, sorry. It's quite strange to use this. However, Caprin is a really interesting being in Kayapo experience. And we can start from Caprin Mekaben, or the history of the turtle. What this history told us, that so much time ago, a long time ago, there were some people in the forest hunting, and one of them was not able to find a tapir or a big prey, so he was running in the forest, and at some moment he listened a strange song in the forest, and he was looking for who is singing here in the forest, and he was running behind this music, and finally, well, this is a quiet resume, but finally he found a turtle who was singing. Wow, amazing this situation. And then he take this turtle, he bring with him at home, and he give it to his wife to cook and to boil it. Yeah, okay. But he gave to his wife only after learning the music. And what is interesting, that this music, that is the Caprin Bang, the music of the turtle is one of the core moment. The singing of this music is one of the core moment of the naming rituals of the woman in the village. So it is the song that produces the effectivity of the naming ritual. What it is a naming ritual? Do you have some idea?
Is it kind of a rite of passage for becoming from a girl to a woman, and you get a new name?
Yeah, is a passage ritual. Yeah, it's a passage ritual. They pass through this several times along the life because they change the name every time. But it is important because the name is something that produces the subjectivity of the people. The name is something is not only a representation of the people, is the people himself or herself. So in this sense, the fact that they use the music of the turtle to obtain the efficacy or the powerful of the ritual, so the fact that the music of the turtle in some sense produce, helping produce the people, let us understand the importance, the emphasis that this music has in this process of production of people, of the proper subjectivities, of proper Mabengo Kre, truly people. And this is really interesting because we have to think another aspect of turtles. That is, as our friend told us, the body painting of turtles. Turtles is used as a model, as a pattern to produce body painting in the people that are participating in the naming ritual. So we have two aspects that are extremely interesting to observe. From one side, from the turtles, we have the music that let the ritual to be effective. So let the people to acquire their names and to become truly recognized in the society. But on the other side, we have also that the body of the people is produced by the turtle. Because if I paint myself as a turtle, in some way, I became a turtle. Is clear? It sounds so strange? No? Okay, I'm happy. But is not finished, because turtles is also the ritual food during these naming rituals, these feminine rituals. Well, you are not so happy. However, they eat a lot of turtles during the naming rituals, a lot of them. But we will see later on that it is not so impacting the ecosystem in Amazon. So we have three aspects by which we can observe that the turtle are productive in the sense that they produce people. So who are the subject and the object in this sense? Turtles, they are acting to produce the people by the music, by the painting, and by the food. So they are producing the name, they are producing the body, the aesthetics of the people, the skin of the people, and they are producing also the substance of the people. Because the people eating turtles, they acquire these substances. And we know that, a small parenthesis, in Amazon, sharing substances is sharing the proper subjectivity position. The position that let us to be subjects and non-object of all the flow of the events. Is clear? So, can you take this one just a moment, please? Yeah, thank you. So, if you have some question, please stop me at every time. Some question about my language, too, if you have. So, what is this turtle? It's, in science, she is called Chelonoidis carbonaria. It's beautiful turtle, isn't it? Yeah. But so now we saw that Kayapo, that Mabengo Kre, they define, they attribute this kind of proper subjectivity qualities to the turtle, in the sense that turtle is able to act to the humans, because turtle gave in the past the music to people, the music that they use to produce people nowadays in the ritual. But turtle continuatively offers something to people. So it is interesting to observe this identification as a subject, this description as a subject. But in ethology, we have some interesting studies that goes in an interesting direction. So an important part, a relevant part of the studies about Chelonoidis is dedicated to ranging patterns, or the moving of the turtles. Well, turtles are small, are slowly, but can go very distant. They can do hundreds of kilometers in their life. So it's something that ethologists are looking to in a very dedicated way. And it is interesting, because this study of ranging patterns is associated with the visual cognitive abilities of the turtles, of the Chelonoidis, of the Caprão, or in Portuguese, Jabuti. Well, we can use several names for it, is okay. But this study of visual cognitive abilities are very, very interesting, because they, in laboratory, they demonstrated that turtles are able to exit from a labyrinth. And more interesting, they can recognize the images of labyrinth, they can produce a map from an iPad. And then from this image of the iPad, they are able to exit to the labyrinth. This is extremely fascinating aspect, because if we remember what happened in the history of the Caprão, of the Jabuti, that the guy to find who was singing, the turtle, needed to run in the forest for a long time. So it is interesting to observe these two aspects. But these visual cognitive abilities let us to think another aspect, what it is. Do you have some idea? How they use this aesthetic?
They recognize each other?
Well, they recognize each other, the turtles, of course, and we will see what happened when they recognize just in a few minutes. But it is interesting, because we can connect this idea of cognitive ability, of visual recognition, as something that is connected with the patterns of body painting. We have an emphasis in aesthetics, both among the Caipo and both here, among the ethologists, among the scientists, hard scientists. Is not all. They recognize one to each other, so they have a social learning. They can transmit the information one to the other. And there are several studies in this direction that they can transmit messages, and they can transmit messages not only the terrestrial turtles, but also the turtles that live in the water are able to communicate one with each other. And it is very interesting, because several studies observed that the first communication is when the babies are still in the eggs of the turtle. The mothers, they produce some vocalization when the babies are still in the eggs. We cannot translate it, but we know that this is a kind of social learning. And this social learning, as I told you, has an expression in some kinds of vocalization. But how are defined by the ethologists this vocalization? And here we have an interesting surprise. Like singing, they define the vocalizations of the turtles as singing, using the term sing. And this is strange if we think that the sound is this one. Thank you. But I think it's sufficient. But would you define this as a music? As a song? Or not? Who of you can put his hand on the fire that it is a song? Wow, why? Why? Are you musicians? Wow, so I will give you this because I'm not able to.
No, it sounds like a kuringa.
Yeah, it remembers. I didn't think about this.
The grape is exactly.
Yeah, this is a fantastic connection. Yeah, we will be back there later on. But it's interesting because, well, you are a musician, so you have this genial idea. However, the ethologists, who are not so genial like an artist, they measure, they take the measure of the sound. And so they recognize some patterns that are frequencies. Well, I think frequencies is the correct term. Yeah. And these are producing a pattern, a repetitivity. So that for this reason, they defined it as singing. Yeah. Let's stop for now with the turtles. We will be back to the turtles later on. And let's talk about kukoi. What is kukoi? A monkey, perfect, a monkey. This is a small monkey we found in the middle of the forest, and this is his hammock. Well, I'm sorry for you that I'm not able to look here, but well, later on you can enter and look the pictures. Yeah, but this is interesting, why? Kukoi, the monkey, has a really interesting position in the Mbengo Cree world, because kukoi can be a mekaron, can be a spirit. When the Mbengo Cree listen to the vocalizations of the monkeys in the forest, they are used to tell that there is some spirit that is there, so they cannot go there so easy, because it can be really, really dangerous. However, they are not only mekaron. They are social beings. In which sense? That Mbengo Cree recognize some forms of social organizations that changes between one kind and the other kind. But why they recognize this different kinds of social organization? Because in mythical times, monkeys were people. In mythical times, there have been some fighting inside the first group of people inhabiting this world, and so a part of this group decided to become the monkeys, decided to change her body to become a monkey, to become another, to produce a difference. However, we will see later that this transformation, this metamorphosis, is bodily, so it is not irreversible. They can come back again, and this is an interesting aspect. But this social being is expressed also because when monkeys are in the village, when they have small babies, that are orphans. Orphans is the term, yeah? They are, they take care of these orphans like proper babies. So some woman will breastfeed the monkeys if they are very young, or if they are quite older, they will have some food. They will have something proper for them. So they are a totally anthropomorphized. Yeah, and it is very interesting for in our observation, because monkeys are also providers of cultural tools. What does it mean, cultural tools? What produces the difference between humans and animals? If we saw now that monkeys are recognized as proper subjects, proper social beings, in the sense that they have a social organization quite similar to the humans one, what produce the difference are exactly these cultural tools, that they have different, they can have different forms, they can be different things, but now I will give you an interesting example of these cultural tools. Okay, so, sorry. What was this? This was the two masks. Well, now there is only one. Okay, yeah. The other one, where it was, I don't know. Yeah. Okay, the two masks of the monkeys. And this is exactly the music of the monkeys. Just a moment, I will drink something. And why they are special interesting? Because we introduced before the time of the body, the discourse about the body. The body is a part that is constitutive of the proper human subjectivities and the human position in the world. So to dress these masks is to become a monkey, is to be a monkey in this moment. And this is the reason why these monkeys are all the time in two, because if they are only one, they will feel bad, because alone they will search for their parents, for their relatives, and so they will fight with all the village to go to the forest, to return to the forest. So they must be all the time in two. Is clear? And this is a really strong ritual in which you can observe that all the other peoples, they don't stay near the masks, exactly because as they are humans who became monkeys, like the mythical time, this can be contagious. This can produce a transformation among the people. So we observe that also in the case of the monkeys, we have a recognition by the Mbengo Kre of the possibility of animals to have a strong influence on the production of the truly human position. You are not sure? No? So what we have? We have a recognition that monkeys can be different kind of beings. And in mythical times, they gave to the humans some cultural tools. One of them are the masks that produce the ritual, okay? Mm-hmm. So they have an influence. On another side, in mythical times, monkeys were people who became monkeys. And in this ritual event, we have a reproposition, a reformulation of this starting point of the existence of monkeys. So this is a moment in which the space-time has some astronomers will call it, is compressed, is reduced. So here we have the present, the past, but also the future. So it's for this reason that it is a very dangerous, and you must take care of what is happening here. You must be careful here. And it is interesting because the use of cultural tools is exactly what define the correct sociality. If you are able to use the tools that they use, that the real people use, so you are part of the humanity. But we will arrive there later. But this idea of tools is really interesting because we will come back to the tools just now. These are the chebus. There are various kinds of chebus in Amazon, of course, yeah, but it's not so relevant, these details. And how they are described by the ethologist and especially by primatologists. Something that is really, really fascinating that primatologists are working so much is the use of multiple tools. We will see some kind of uses in a few minutes. But this is interesting because chebus are the unique family in neotropicals, among neotropical primates, that is able to use tools. Well, we have big apes in the old world, in Africa, using tools. So, for example, chimps, gorillas. But in the new world, in Amazon and tropical America, we have only the chebus who are able to use these tools. So this makes a difference between chebus and other kind of primates. And this is something really important. Because there is a process, in this case too, like for the turtles, of social learning of the use of these tools. Primatologists describe various forms of learning of these tools through formalized processes of transmission of this knowledge. Is clear? Every time if someone has some question, can take up his hand and stop me, okay? So this process of social learning bring with him the possibility also to acquire new skills, to learn constantly different abilities and learn how to manage different kind of tools. Not only tools, but also other military strategies, if we want. Let me open a small parenthesis. Some years ago, I was in a university in Brazil, and I was invited to give a conference like now, yes, something similar. However, in the garden in front of the building, there were so many chebus, and I didn't know that they were able to do all of this. So I was eating my sandwich, and I was, I don't know the name in English, surrounded by a troop of chebus, and I lost my sandwich. It was something really incredible. Wow, and I think that they can read some books to do this. And so what does it mean? That if they are able to acquire new skills, primatologists told us that also they are able of abstract knowledge, abstract thinking.